Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Buddhang Dhammang Sanghang Namassami. I'm very happy to be here at BIA once again and to be invited to share some reflections on the Dhamma. When I was asked if I would like to give a talk, I asked what was the there was a particular theme or program going on at this time, and discussed with the team here, and so we settled on this title about Nibbāna. So the theme for this evening is we need to talk about Nibbāna. So that's perhaps you don't agree, but but I kind of took the words out of the mouth of Tanajan Buddhadāsa, and some of you will be familiar with his book Nibbāna for Everyone, and there's other aspects of the teaching that he has written about, spoken about many times over the years, and particularly one of the themes that that he was making very clear is that we have some strange ideas about Nibbāna in Buddhist tradition, in Thailand or in the West or other places, and so that it's good to clarify, you know, what do we mean by this word Nibbāna or Nirvana in Sanskrit, and what use does this word have for us, what kind of meaning might it have in our life. And so because Tanajan Buddhadāsa felt this was so important, in his own words he said, if we don't talk about Nibbāna, Buddhism is as good as dead. You know, he's a very uju speaker, as we know. Tanajan Buddhadāsa doesn't hold back. He's very straightforward. But I think that's an important statement to contemplate, to reflect on. If we don't talk about Nibbāna, Buddhism is as good as dead. So that's a statement to get our attention, and I think also a good starting point for the reflections this evening. I just happen to have written a book about Nibbāna too. So myself and Lompo Pasanno spent about 10 years writing this book. It's in English. There is a Thai translation in process. Someone very bravely has taken that on, but it doesn't exist in print yet. There's a Spanish version, any Spanish speakers, and a German version is being produced, but this one is the English version, and it begins with the statement that sort of chapter 1, line 1, begins with a statement about the meaning of the word. Nibbāna, or Nirvana in Sanskrit, is a word that is used to describe an experience when the heart is free of all obscurations and is utterly in accord with nature, ultimate reality, Dhamma. It experiences perfect peace, joy, and contentment. This set of qualities is what Nibbāna describes. The purpose of this book is to outline particular teachings of the Buddha that point to and illuminate that these ways can be realized. From the Buddhist point of view, the realization of Nibbāna is the fulfillment of the highest human potential, a potential that exists in all of us, regardless of nationality or creed. So, when we consider Nibbāna, then, it's talking about an experience, and so that the way that the word is used in different Buddhist cultures can vary a lot, and so that the way that it's regarded is that at the end of a life the life of an arahant, then they realize Nibbāna, or they go to Nibbāna, Tung Nibbān, Chamai? So it represents Nibbāna as some kind of super heaven, like a kind of special prize, the kind of really the best kind of retirement home for, where, you know, it's like such a super heaven, the arahants stay there forever and never get born again into any other realm. And so this is I'm kind of joking, but kind of not joking. You know, this is the language that we very easily use, and that in Ajahn Buddhadasa's teachings, he makes it very clear. He said, Nibbana has got nothing to do with death, but rather Nibbana is speaking about the potential, the quality of the heart when it awakens to reality, to its own reality, to the reality of all things. When the heart awakens to Dhamma, then the word Nibbana refers to the experience of that. What is felt in the heart when it knows the truth, when the heart awakens to Nibbana, and awakens to the Dhamma, what it feels is Nibbana. So the word Nibbana itself, where does that come from? Again, borrow from Tanajan Buddhadasa's description, he makes it clear the word Nibbana is an ordinary household word in the Indian languages. The example he gave was, if you've cooked a pot of rice, it's too hot to eat, so you put it on the side to cool down a bit. You let the rice Nibbana before it's the right temperature to eat. So it just means cool down, yen nitnoi. It means it's everything is just allowed to cool down. And so it's not a very kind of refined word. It's not a sort of deeply philosophical or an unusual word. It just means cooled down, chilled out. So the Buddha, just like Ajahn Buddhadasa, was like to make statements that get our attention. The Buddha was, the kind of original user of this method, we could say, that he liked to speak in ways that would get people's attention, and that in his time, spiritual seekers, they thought in terms of generating tapas. You know the word tapas? So it's a Sanskrit word, also a Pali word, meaning heat. So if you have a lot of spiritual power, it's considered like you've got a lot of heat, a lot of tapas. And the more kind of austerity, the more kind of painful practice that you do, the more tapas you generate, the more kind of palang, the more power you generate. So the word heat, tapas, was considered like the more tapas you've got, then the better, the more powerful you are as a spiritual practitioner. And so Lord Shiva was considered the kind of ultimate tapasin, the kind of supreme sort of spiritually powerful being. And that quality of heat was considered the ultimate strength or goodness. So then the Buddha uses the opposite, coolness. No, not heat. Let's go for coolness, Nibbana. Not heating up, not more heat, less heat, not long. Kind of lower it down, turn it down to coolness. And so it was a skillful means that he used, and by my understanding, to help get people's attention, that we're not talking about what you're familiar with. We're talking about something else altogether. We're talking about cooling down. And when he spoke about that, so what is it that's cooling down? It's the fire of greed, hatred, and delusion, of loba, greed, dosa, moha. Now, one of the things about Nibbana and why we need to talk about it, along with the idea of it being some kind of super heaven, like this sort of where arahants go when they pass away, or when where the Buddha's gone to, which is not supported to any kind of degree in the Buddha's teaching. There's nowhere that the Buddha implies that or makes any hint of that. But still, people like to think that. So then they think, well, you go to this super heaven, but you can't take your family with you. You know, you're not going to be reborn, so that, you know, what about your grandchildren? And what about the dog? If I can't take my dog with me, I don't want to go to Nippon. So many Dhamma teachers like Lumpo Cha or Lumpu Man or the Thanajan Buddhadāsa, the great teachers of our time, oftentimes their students would say, "Yeah, I don't want to go to Nibbāna. I don't want to realize Nibbāna because it's kind of, it's got an off-putting quality. Kajai mai? It's kind of like, it's mai ao, mai sanuk, that there's not that kind of feeling of warmth or happiness there. It's so that many teachers talk about that in the teachings of Lumpu Man, Lumpu Cha. They say, people, when you talk about realizing Nibbana, they say, "Oh, no thanks, I want to be reborn. I want to go to heaven for a bit, then come back." And then, and if they say, "What I want to do is, I don't want to go to Nippon, and I want to just make a lot of merit, go to heaven, then come back to earth when Sri Arya Maitri, when the next Buddha comes along. Then it'll be really easy to become an arahant when there's a Buddha, and then maybe I'll become an arahant then." And the Lumpu Cha go, "My chala loi," not very smart, it's also a bit of a gamble. People say, I don't want to develop insight now, because if I develop insight now, I might become a stream enterer, and that means seven more lifetimes. That could be really hard work before Ben Samret. So maybe if I just make enough merit, go to heaven, come back when Sri Arya Maitri is here, and then can hop off the wheel then. He said, "You must be a gambler. Those are really bad odds." that's really a long shot. Don't think that way. So Lumpu Cha would try to change people's view and say, "Why do you think Nibbana is a bad idea? Why do you not want to go there? Why do you not want to realize that? Why do you think it's something that is unpleasant?" The Buddha said, "Nibbanaṃ paramaṃ sukhaṃ." Nibbana is the supreme happiness. He also said, "Nibbana is the supreme arya satya, is the supreme noble truth." It's the one time he talks about Nibbana as like the fifth noble truth, the supreme noble truth of Nibbana. In the Dhatu Vibhanga Sutta, he says Nibbana is the supreme noble truth. So if he gives it such praise and says it's the highest happiness, why do we not want to go there? What's the cause of that? So that's interesting to consider. And I think why we need to talk about Nibbana or why that ending of rebirth might seem to be kind of make us uncomfortable is because of our attachment, because of sakkaya ditti, attachment to our body, to our personality, to our family, to our things, our life, our home, our pets. In England, oftentimes people are more attached to the dog and the cat than they are to the family. I'm English by birth, so, And my parents met because they were dog breeders. In England, we have a strong relationship to the cats and dogs. But people really feel that way. I'm not trying to make fun, but people say, "I don't want to go there if I can't take my dog with me, or will I see my family again?" So this represents sakkaya ditti, the kind of yatir dorton, the attachment to the body, the personality, and so that feeling of "ooh, I don't like that idea," it's coming from, I would say, that the hate, the source of that, is the attachment that we have to the body, to the personality. So when we use the Pali sakkaya ditti, it literally means the view of the real body, or the view of the real person. So you can summarize that, you can express that as the belief, "I am the body, I am the personality." So that means you think, "I am a woman, I am a man, I am 62 years old, I am English, I am a Theravada monk." Those statements which are, say, conventionally true, we take them to be ultimately true. Kachai mai? So instead of a samuti satya, like I am a man, we say, oh, that's a paramata satya, that's an absolute truth. And because of that mistake, we think, I am the body, I'm the personality. So when you say, but you are a man, Ajahn, you're a monk, you couldn't be a monk if you weren't a man, but the process of vipassana meditation, insight meditation, that helps us to examine that. So, like right now, we say, this is Suan Mok, this is the Dharma hall at Suan Mok. So the air in this hall, the oxygen, is part of Suan Mok, Krung Thep, chai mai? This is BIA, Suan Mok Krung Thep, chai mai? So then I breathe in. So I take the oxygen in, so that which was now Suan Mok Krung Thep is now Amaro. The oxygen gets, there's a few doctors and nurses here. You remember your biology exams? So the oxygen gets joined to my blood, to my hemoglobin. So then that oxygen, it went from being Thai Suan Mok Krung Thep oxygen to being Amaro English monk oxygen. Did it? Or is it just oxygen? At what point did it go from being Suan Mok Krung Thep to being Amaro? And then when that oxygen gets bound to carbon and comes out as carbon dioxide, then it stops being man, stops being English, and becomes Thai. Yeah, chai mai? If it's in here, then it's English. Out there, it's Thai. This is a samuti satya. Ka chai mai? So these are just, even though we can say, yeah, on my passport it says male. Yeah, I'm a bhikkhu. My chromosomes are X and Y. So, technically male, but what makes maleness is compounded, is conditioned, it's put together. So it's a conventional truth, kong samut. And so when we are able to see through that, and through vipassana, kamatan, we investigate that feeling of dua don, I and me and mine. Again, Ajahn Buddhadāsa has written often about this book, I and Mine, Me and Mine, you know, that... this is the cause of that hesitation, that kind of what we call holding back, like, ooh, I don't want to go there. Yeah, it won't be me anymore. I won't be able to see my family. So this is my suggestion, but I think it's important for us to encourage ourselves to look. Okay, when it talks about Tung Nipan, something in me goes, ooh, what is it? Where does that come from? What is the source of that? So you look for yourself, you investigate, pijarana, explore for yourself. Now, when we look at the teachings and we consider the that nature of reality, you know, and we consider that the Buddha said Nibbana is the highest happiness, Nibbana is the supreme noble truth, then we think, well, why is it so off-putting, or why does it seem something that's challenging? If we look at the teachings, say there's two suttas in the Udana, the beginning of chapter 8 of the Udana, and in those teachings, I can... Since I've got the book here, I can read it. Since I have a copy of the book right here, I can read it for you, so I won't have to remember. So, this is from chapter 8 of the Udana. The Buddha says, there is that sphere, that ayatana, that domain of being, where there is no earth, no water, no fire, nor wind, no sphere of infinity of space, of infinity of consciousness, of nothingness, or even of neither perception nor non-perception. There is neither this world nor the other world, neither moon nor sun. This sphere of being, this ayatana, I call neither a coming nor a going nor a staying still, neither a dying nor a reappearance. It has no basis, no evolution, and no support. This, just this, is the end of dukkha. So, no sun, no moon, no stars, no going forward, no going back, no standing still. What is that? How is that? What? How can that be? But so this is one of the few places that the Buddha talks about that quality of realization, or the nature of Dhamma itself. So to the mind that is attached to this body, the personality, to time, to identity, to dodon, and to the place, to the ti, the mind that says, well, I am a person and I am here and I was born, I'm 62 years old and this is my life, the mind that's attached to that is very threatened. This is dangerous. Like, I'm going to lose everything. Everything that I am is gone. So how could that be the end of suffering? Everything is wiped out. No moon, no stars, no sun. Everything is just annihilated. But obviously the Buddha is saying, you know, this is the end of suffering. But also when he was challenged, many people said, oh, you're talking about annihilation. So you mean Nibbāna or enlightenment. This is, everything is wiped out. You know, this being is destroyed. And he said, no. There are many people who say that I describe the annihilation, the destroying of an existent being. But that's not what I teach. And those people who say that, they misrepresent me. Yeah. So what he's saying is that the appearance, the fact that we seem to be an independent, self-existent being, that's the mistake. That we think that I was born, therefore I will die, or I exist in time. But he's saying that sense of being an individual, being born, the sense of time passing, these are just appearances. Can you follow? So difficult to follow, but it's important to understand why. So to our ordinary thinking mind, but I'm sitting here, and time is passing. It's now 6:28. We started at 6 o'clock, and you are Ajahn Amaro, and I'm listening to you, and I'm this person, and you're that person. So to our senses, eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and the thinking mind, that time, identity, and place, they all seem to be absolutely real. But what the Buddha is saying is that if the mind sees clearly, it recognizes, no, that's not the whole story. Time is an appearance. Identity, the duodon, is an appearance. It's the way things look. And location, the ti, where we are, that's also just an appearance. So to our thinking mind and to our senses, this is deliberately what we call mind-blowing. Because our normal way of thinking doesn't apply. So Lumpo Cha, he liked to give people, like Ajahn Buddhadāsa and like the Buddha, he would like to challenge people, to make them think. He'd ask a question when someone came to visit. He'd say, if you can't go forwards and you can't go backwards and you can't stand still, where do you go? You go, climb a tree? My chai. What I do? Can't climb a tree. Dig a hole? Can't dig a hole. Go sideways? Can't go sideways either. So you can't go forward, you can't go back, you can't stand still, you can't climb a tree, you can't dig a hole, you can't go sideways. Where do you go? What can you do? And so people would try and figure it out, or and so Lumpur would let people kind of puzzle or suffer a bit, and eventually, you know, he'd say the only way that the mind can solve this puzzle is to let go. To let go of the body, let go of time, let go of place. That he said the Buddha Dhamma is not to be found in moving forwards, nor in moving backwards, nor in standing still. It's the place of what we call non-abiding. Kachai mai? Like mai mi ti. There's no abiding place, no place to land. And Lumpo was very good at giving good examples. He said, you know, if you look at this building, we have the ground floor with the concrete. That's a birth. That's a bop, a power. That's a place of birth. And then the upper story, where there's the floor and the room of the kuti, then that's also a pop, a power, a place of birth. But in between, between the floor up there and the floor down here. But in this space, there's no place to stand. Say, this is Nibbāna, where there's no place to stand. So that, again, that might not sound very helpful. But it's what he's pointing to is like we, as a person, we're looking for that something to be, some place to land, something to identify with. Well, I am a man, or I am a woman, I am a monk, I am a Mechi, I am a Thai, I'm an English, I'm American. That's what I am. And he say, Blaiwan, let go. And when we develop Satipanya, mindfulness and wisdom, and the mind looks at its own nature, Jit Jai Kong Rao Ru Du Eng, when the jit knows itself, then the jit, when the mind looks at its own nature, there's a realization that the Dhamma is sanditiko, apparent here and now, akaliko, timeless. Time doesn't apply. Ehi pasiko, opanaiko, and so on. So that when we look also at the mind, we say, well, where is the mind? Jit yutinai. So place, again, not to get too kind of far out, but if you think about it, place, the location of something, only applies to rupakanda, chamai, to rup. For the namakandas, feeling, perception, sankhan, vinyan, mamiti, the mind does not exist any place. The mind is, but place does not apply. Chamai, where does my mind stop and yours begin? Kind of this far? Or this far? Or that? It doesn't apply. Chit jai kong rao, mami ti. So we say, oh, my mind if you're a Farang, or my mind if you're Thai. But the mind doesn't really have a location. And when we practice vipassana meditation, when the mind is watching its own activity, its own experiences, then there can be that recognition. Oh, this I say, I'm experiencing sight, sound, smell, taste, touch, thought, arising and passing away here, but when the mind looks, it's like, well, here doesn't really apply. There, it doesn't really have a place. Kajaimai? Can you follow? So, the teaching of Lompo Cha then, that if you can't go forward, you can't go back, you can't stand still, where do you go? It's a trick question, because you can't go anywhere. The mind can let go of you. Let's go. Ploy dua don, ploy dua don, ploy wela, ploy ti. Kachai mai? So when the mind is really awake, when it ru jem jeng, when it knows clearly, and is has let go of any kind of attachment, any kind of grasping at the body, grasping at sight, sound, smell, taste, touch, grasping at thinking, grasping at the dua don, then the mind is awake. It doesn't have a place, it doesn't exist anywhere, it doesn't have an identity. The mind knows those feelings of the body or the memories and the thoughts. It knows those aspects of the person arising and passing. But, and this is difficult to understand, but the mind which knows the person is not a person. Chit ru ru tu ton, mari ben tu ton. Chit ru kon, mari ben kon. So that which knows the person is not a person. We say the puru or the tat ru, mari ben kon, ben tam, ben jit ben tam, mari ben kon. So we can say the heart, the jitta, is dhamma, it's not a person. It knows the aspects of the person, the body and feelings, perceptions, arising and passing, but it's not personal. It's not female or male. It's not tall or short. It doesn't have an age. Doesn't have a location. So when the Buddha was asked about this, the nature of the Arahant, and the people came to speak to him, a young Brahmin student called Upasiva, and he was also talking about what happens to an Arahant when the body dies. He said, do they go to some kind of super heaven, or do they no longer exist? So Upasiva asked the Buddha that very question. is that they kind of go to some kind of immortal place where they're happy forever in some super heaven, or they kind of disappear altogether. What happens? And so then the Buddha said to Upasiva, this is in the Sutta Nipata, so the Buddha said to Upasiva, one who has reached the end has no criterion, no way, no method by which they can be measured. That which can be spoken of is no more. The body is gone, personality is gone. You cannot say they do not exist, but when all modes of being, all phenomena have been removed, all means of speaking have gone as well. So it's like across that border, ordinary concepts and language don't apply. How can you describe a being when there's no individuality, no time, no place? Because our language is all about sanya. It's all about seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching. We have an animal body. It's located in this spot. So all of our language and our thought is based on the perceptions, on the sanya. So how do you describe a universe beyond sanya? Come by me, no? The words run out. And so that, again, the Ajahn Buddhadāsa, he used this kind of language to describe that. He said the thinking mind falls flat. It's like it meets the Dhamma, really. The conceptual mind, the thinking mind that produces words and ideas, it kind of it falls over. It collapses. It has no real means. So this is why when people asked about the Buddha, well, you know, being an arahant is that's the fulfillment of the human potential. So that's really great. And so when an arahant passes away, that must be like something really, really good. And throughout his life, the Buddha never spoke about that. He described the path to realize arahantship. But when people say, well, what happens? Where do they go? He would say, well, you know, they doesn't apply. Going doesn't apply. And the time into the future doesn't apply. So no words can apply. So he knew he was being misunderstood. So that people would say, so therefore they just disappear, they're annihilated. He said, no, I don't teach the annihilation of an existent being. You misunderstand. But the words run out, the concepts run out, so nothing can be spoken of. So like he said to Upasiva, one who has reached the end has no criterion by which they can be measured. There's no way you can measure that. How can you describe something which has no, without time, without space, without identity? Words can't apply because the words are crafted for this, the world of seeing, smelling, hearing, tasting, touching, and three-dimensional space. Now, India is a land of philosophers, nak brat, yet yet, no? And they're really expert. And they had a lot of really long words. And so you think, well, maybe the Buddha could have kind of come up with some really great philosophical terms to describe exactly what life is like on the other side of that border. But he said, no, even talking about a border, my chai, it's like, it's all giving the wrong signals because the mind really wants to create a person. He wants to create a place. He wants to create a time. And he realized, even though I will be misunderstood, it's better to speak in terms of the reality of the experience and to just leave it that other quality undescribed. So that's what he did the whole of his teaching career. The most he ever said was, this is one who has reached the end has realized absolute bliss. When he's talking about Dabba Maliputta, he says, such a one realizes ultimate bliss, unutterable bliss. That's all you get. So it's really good, but you don't get any more than that. And so I feel that's one of the reasons why we need to talk about Nibbana, is because we think of it as something I will be experiencing, or I can experience here and now, or I will be experiencing in the future, and it'll be some special place. But the teachings are pointing to a different quality. And that also, as long as we put that into the form of my life, my mind, and me passing through time, that's always going to be a distortion. So that we won't be seeing it clearly. So in again, in Lumpur Cha's teachings, Ajahn Buddhadasa's teachings, they would talk about the Nibbāna, not as just some kind of remote, distant goal off in the future, but something much more close to home. And again, in Ajahn Buddhadasa's book, Nibbāna for Everyone, he has in bold print, strong black print, Nibbāna has got nothing to do with death. Because again, people often say Nibbāna as when an arahant dies, but actually in the teachings, Nibbāna is when the mind is enlightened, when it is samrat lao, when it reaches enlightenment, right then is the experience of Nibbāna. Kind of that it's not when the body dies, but it's that when the heart is free of greed, hatred, and delusion, then that felt sense of that the mind is that of peacefulness, Nibbāna. So when Ajahn Chah was asked to define Nibbāna, what is Nibbāna? He described it in a very, very simple way. He said, the reality of non-grasping is Nibbāna. The reality of non-grasping is Nibbāna. So, kwam ching ploy wang, ma yut tue ben Nibbāna. Very simple. Not anything to do with heaven, body dying. Yeah, maybe what I was saying about the kind of that ayatana where there is no sun, no moon, no stars, and no coming, no going, that's kind of, it's a bit too far out, too mind-blowing. But we all know the experience of grasping, kwam yit tue. We know that feeling of, I like, this is mine, I hate, this is good, that's awful. This is my space. We know that feeling of grasping, right? I'm not reading anybody's mind. This is not Abhinihan, this is statistics, as I often say. We're all this way. So the reality of non-grasping. So what that means is, right now, when the mind lets go of anything it's grasping, then that letting go, that's the cooling down. That's letting the rice kind of yin, 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 yin noi. It's letting the heart cool down. So that grasping is a state of heat and tension, and that letting go in that moment when the heart is free of grasping, right there is Nibbāna. So it's not a kind of explosion. You don't get rainbows and devatas with trumpets or the kind of say, hooray, well done. It's a completely ordinary kind of quiet simplicity. You can say it's perfectly normal. So in the English word normal, like the Thai word tamada, it's not exciting, right? It's normal. It's just a normal Tuesday evening. It's just a Wednesday. It's normal. Yeah, this is a normal Dhamma talk. Maybe not totally normal. It's just normal. So normal, tamada, tamada, tamada. It's just kind of nothing special, no need to pay any attention, doesn't have much value. Chame? But the word tamada, I'm not very good at reading Thai language, but if you look at the word tamada, it's got the word dhammata, tamma, right? Tamada has the word tam in it. So that's the clue. The word tamada comes from the Pali dhammata, of the nature of dhamma. So hidden in the ordinary is the dhamma itself. The dhamma. So I'm teaching Thai people Thai language. So dhammata, it's of the nature of dhamma. So hidden in the ordinary is the very extraordinary. Hidden in the normal is the norm, which is another word for the Dhamma. So that we overlook peace. When when that peace of the mind is there, we don't notice it. When the heart relaxes and we stop grasping, we just look for the next interesting thing, right? The next thing to worry about, the next thing to get excited about, the next thing to have an opinion about. So as Lumpo Sumedho would often say, peace is boring. Yeah, he'd say, you know, if you printed a newspaper with Ajahn Sumedho breathed in and then he breathed out. He said, like, if they put that on the cover of the Daily Mirror, it wouldn't sell very many copies. You know, if you said, yeah, Ajahn Sumedho runs away with a 16-year-old girl, you'd sell a lot of copies. You know. That's kind of exciting news.
Ooh, terrible.
Let me see. You know. But Ajahn Sumedho breathed in and then he breathed out. Big deal. You know, so what? So peace is boring. It's not exciting. So therefore the attention misses it. So when we reflect on that, and we are looking at that through our experience, again through meditation and the development of vipassana, you know, if you pick up something and you grasp it, you're kind of taking hold of it, there's a tension, like my arm is shaking, there's a tension, a tightness. And so then to stop grasping, you don't have to throw it away, you just relax. I'm still holding it, but I'm not grasping it. There's no tension. There's no dukkha. So we can explore that and say, okay, now, so there's the tension there, and then I relax. So for about 2 or 3 seconds, 3 or 4 seconds, there's a, ah, thank goodness that's over. Or like when you hear a loud noise, like if the air conditioner's going and it switches off, you go, oh, it's silent. Ah. Or there's a lot of traffic outside and the traffic stops and it goes quiet. You go, oh. How long does that ah last? 1, 2, 3 seconds? Maybe? Maybe 4 seconds? Maximum. Then, okay. What else is going on, right? That's how we all are. Because peace is boring. When it's a contrast to stress, it's like, ah, oh, whew, thank goodness that's over. Like if you've been working around your home and you've been tidying things up, doing the dishes or kind of finishing off for some correspondence and you kind of get everything done, you put it away, you sit down on a chair, ah, whew. Finally got all those letters written or got the dishes done. And then you sit down, ah, 1, 2, 3, okay. So what else is there to do? I'm sure I'm supposed to be doing something. There's, oh yes, yeah. And then you feel relieved when you remember the other duties that you have. Chamai? You remember something else you're supposed to be worrying about. It's another problem, but you're glad to have the problem because you feel unsettled with that kind of that empty space. So that's like the space between the two floors that Lumpo Cha was talking about. That empty space, we don't know what to do with it. We can't stand there. There isn't anything to get hold of. So we think of it as nothing, as bad, as worthless. But you know that space right there is Nibbāna. Yeah, right there is the Dhamma is apparent. But we overlook it because it's not a thing. It doesn't grab our attention. It's not interesting. So a lot of the training or the practice or why we need to think about Nibbāna is that Nibbāna is accessible here and now. Like the Dhamma is available, it's accessible here and now. But we keep missing it because we get interested in what's that over there? Or I should be doing this. Our attention is taken up by seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, thinking, remembering, planning, social media, you know, checking our phone. Yeah, how many line messages have I got? Yeah. Any more followers on Instagram? Any less followers on Instagram? You know, what's happening to my profile? Yeah, I don't have a profile, but just. I know many people do. So, the practice then becomes how to realize Nibbāna, how to bring the mind to notice the peace that is there when the grasping stops. Now, certainly, just relaxing the hand for a moment is not arahantship, when kind of irreversible ending of suffering. But it is what they call tadangana nibbana, or momentary nibbana. Again, Tanajan Buddhadasa spoke about this quite often, the tadangana vimutti, temporary liberation or temporary nibbana. And so in that moment, to some degree, there is the flavor of nibbana, there's the taste of nibbana. And it's there's a quality of purity, simplicity, a kind of quiet normality. So then the trick or the skill that needs to be developed to realize nibbana is to keep the attention on that space. And when the mind goes, what about, and that right there, that's the urge for birth. That's the mind looking for a rebirth. If you want to understand rebirth, right there. It's like, I should be doing something. I should be worrying about something. I must, right, that's the seed of rebirth. So if that is recognized and let go of and known just as another mental formation, another sankhara, just let it go, and let the attention stay with that silence, that space, that peacefulness, then, and letting that agitation end, then the mind can open up, can realize that quality of peacefulness. When the Buddha spoke about the development of the Four Noble Truths, so the first noble truth, the dukkha parinyayanti, it needs to be recognized, needs to be that there is dukkha. Second noble truth, dukkha samudaya, needs to be let go of, pahata banti. The third noble truth of dukkha nirodha, sachikata banti, it needs to be realized. So when the dukkha has stopped, we need to recognize that. And as I've been saying, what happens when the dukkha stops is that we notice for 2 or 3 seconds and then we don't realize it. We just get on to the next thing to be interested in or to be worried about or to be excited about. So, sachikata banti, that it needs to be realized, is bringing the attention to that absence of dukkha, that absence of stress. Let the heart really know that. And any of you who've read many of Lumpo Sumedho's books or listened to his teachings will know he talks about this a lot. This is, in a way, the most important of the Four Noble Truths, is that the third one, because the others are much more visible, tangible. You can see them, you can touch them, you can feel them. But recognizing space, noticing silence, noticing peace, that takes a lot of effort. You've got to go against the habit of the senses, of the eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind, because the senses are all geared towards interesting things. What's exciting, what's dangerous, what's frightening, what's a problem. So it takes a special kind of effort to notice space, to notice silence and stillness, peacefulness. But if the heart is trained to do that, then that space or that silence, that peace, which seems to be a kind of a nothing, there's a kind of flowering, if you like. It takes on a quality of liveliness. It's like the heart awakens to, there's no thing here. Oh. It's like if you go into a room, you're looking for somebody, and you go into a room, Dun is not here. Okay, carry on looking in the next room. So that space is just an absence of the person you're looking for. It's like, okay, I'm looking for Dun. Dun's not here. Okay, keep searching. If instead of that, you come into the room, Dun's not here. Okay, stop. Pay attention. Let yourself be still. Listen to the silence. Feel the space. Notice the stillness. Peacefulness. Oh, this is really nice. Because you're seeing it as an absence of the thing you were looking for, but actually the Dhamma is ever present. What's there in the room is the Dhamma itself that we overlook. There is that quality of peace, of purity, of stillness. It's always here, but we miss it, we overlook it. So if we take those moments to stop, be still, notice, then, again, you don't have to believe me, but experiment for yourself. Notice that quality of of flowering, of kind of that silence blossoms, like a flower opening. Then probably most of us have had this experience, but we kind of don't know what to do with it, and then we just get on to the next thing. But to develop the realization of Nibbāna, to help the heart incline, lean towards Nibbāna, then take the opportunity to notice space, to notice that stillness, that silence that's always here, even in the midst of noise and activity. It can't go anywhere else. It's always here. And then we find Nibbāna for everyone. So Nibbāna is not just some sort of special heaven that arahants go to, but rather it's the peace of your own mind. It's the peace that is here when the grasping and the identification stops, when the mind is not distracted by the superficial, the surface level, but it opens to the presence of the reality of this moment, that which is behind the appearance, that stillness that is behind movement, the silence that is behind sound, the space that is behind and permeating form, then that the heart will be able to realize and awaken to Nibbāna here and now. And not just when the Dhamma talk finishes, or when you get home, or when you sit in a quiet place, but it's ever present. It's sanditiko, apparent here and now. So I offer these thoughts for consideration about why we might need to talk about Nibbāna, and open things up for some questions. So please don't be shy and wait for the microphone to reach you.
Yeah. If you have the question, please put your hand up and then I will start bringing the microphone to you. I just remind you, please keep the question clear and short. So everybody have a chance to ask the question to Pah Ajahn.
Thank you for the Dhamma talk. Actually, I have a few questions. Let's start with the first one. I heard that once we are in the state of like Sodaban, right? The current to Nibbāna, we will not be able to get kicked out of the current, and we will be like a reborn for 7 times in order to get to the Nibbāna. Or does it depend on the causes and conditions? If we do some bad things, right, we will be kicked out of the current to Nibbāna.
It's a good question. According to the teachings, just exactly as you said, that once Sotapanna has been, that level has been realized, then the Buddha made it very clear that a being would have no more than 7 lifetimes before realizing total enlightenment, arahantship, and they can't be reborn in any of the lower realms. So that they say the gates to the lower realms are closed. So once the mind has reached Sotapanna, then you can't be reborn as an animal, or as a preta, a hungry ghost, or in the hell realms. The gates to the lower realms are closed. So a being will be born in the human realm or in the Deva realm, or Brahma realm, and then it will be no more than 7 lifetimes. What happens in those 7 lifetimes can be all kinds of things. There can be a lot of difficulty and pain, or things could be very easy, or a mixture. But the Buddha made it clear there could be no more than 7 lifetimes. That's guaranteed. And he used these examples, like he reached down and scratched the ground and said, "What do you think? What's greater, the earth under my fingernail, or the great earth itself, the planet itself?" He said, "Venerable Sir, the amount of earth under your fingernail is very small, and the great earth itself is very large." And the Buddha said, "Exactly. The amount of suffering one who has not reached the breakthrough can expect to experience in the future is comparable to the earth. The amount of suffering one who has reached the breakthrough, who has reached Sotapanna, can expect to experience is comparable to the dirt under my fingernail." So, and he uses a whole series of 13 different suttas but he uses those kind of examples to say, you know, it makes a big difference. So actually, the about four chapters of this book are about Sodaban. Because Lumpur Pasanno's section of the book, half the book is done by me, half by Lumpur Pasanno. And so he wanted to emphasize that because people think, oh, it's too difficult to be an arahant, I'm a layperson, you know, I've got too many attachments, I've got so many responsibilities. But he makes a lot of effort to say, well, you know, we tend to want the kind of the biggest, the bestest, the strongest, the kind of the latest, you know, iPhone X plus one, you know. But you know, it's that we don't. Instead of always wanting the best and the highest, sometimes we want to actually aim for the most practical. So he encourages people to be aiming for Sodaban as a doable goal, a realizable goal for a layperson as well as a monastic, because you have this guarantee repeated over and over by the Lord Buddha that, you know, if that breakthrough is reached, then enlightenment is completely unavoidable. Again, there could be a lot of pain and difficulty along the way, but that total enlightenment is guaranteed within seven lifetimes.
Thank you.
Dear Ajahn Amara, dear Sangha, dear friends, thank you for your Dhamma talk. From my understanding, from your teaching, it seems that once the mind has an ability to stop grasping, we can get an experience to have a touch of Nibbāna.
Exactly.
And for the beginner, how to practice to stop grasping. Well, do you have an easiest way to practice? Like, for me, it seems not too difficult to get a touch of Nibbāna from your teaching.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's kind of, I have a hope to get there as well. Like, not sitting still, closing my eyes and do meditation, but from your teaching, it seems very easy to get tiny touch of Nibbāna.
Yes. Yeah. Well, when Lumpur Sumedho was a samanera, when he was a novice, he lived in a monastery in Nong Khai back in 1966, long, 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 long time ago. Probably most of you weren't even born then. Not yet. So 1966, and so he was reading the Dhamma teachings. He just had he had one book that he'd read 80 times, called The Word of the Buddha. And he was reading it. It's all about the Pali teachings of the Four Noble Truths. And so he saw that, okay, this teaching about pahata banti, the needs to be let go of, dukkha needs to be let go of, so letting go. Letting go. So how do you let go? What is this about letting go? And so he said he picked up something like it was a matchbox or a stick in his kuti. He said, okay, so now I'm grasping. So I'm holding, I'm clinging. Okay, so this is clinging. Okay, so then what's letting go? Is it throwing it away or is it just relaxing? Yeah, okay. So that's clinging, that feels like this, and then letting go is like this. So he literally used that physical object and physically grasping it as a way to instruct himself, to guide himself. And he said, okay, and so that dukkha nirodha is the ending of grasping. Oh! And so in that moment, just even on a physical level, just that feeling of that right there is the taste of Nibbāna. Now, the trick is that, as I said, it's boring. And the conditioning of the senses is like, yeah, okay, right, that's good for like 3 seconds, but like, let's do something. You know, I'm hungry, or I'm want some information here. You know, what's on the news? Or So, yes, we get a taste of it, but then the sort of part two is then developing the taste for more of it. To in a sense, develop that as a refuge, as a something that the mind delights in, it rejoices in. Because one of the qualities of a spiritual practitioner that the Buddha says is such a one delights in peace rather than delighting in excitement or delighting in sort of independence rather than being needy. So that the follow through, if you like, if you know that term, like what's implied by that, that's in a way that the hardest work. To get a taste for it is like, oh, this is good. But then staying with that is the work, because the conditioning of our eye, our ears and nose, tongue, body and mind is to want stuff, to want to engage, even wanting a fight. I mean, sometimes in a monastery, some people will get into arguments just because they want something to happen. They don't really have a problem, they just want something to do, you know. Anything will do, like, give me something, like give me an obsession or a worry or an enemy, something, you know, just. And so that bhava tanha, the desire to be, is very, very strong. So that along with that, yeah, the taste of nibbana, yes, but then most of the work is freeing the heart from that addiction to bhava tanha. That's kind of the drug of humanity. And the Buddha saw that after his enlightenment. He said, living beings, and why he was inclined not to even try teaching. He said, living beings, they're addicted to becoming. They relish becoming, the bhava, to existence. They only know becoming. And so to try and teach would be impossible. No one's going to understand this. Therefore, there's no point me even attempting this. And so that it's like realizing the entire world is filled with addicts. You know, people who are addicted to alcohol or heroin, and you're the only non-addict. How do I start? Where do you begin to get people off the stuff? And realizing I'm free of the addiction, but every other human being is addicted. So his first thought was, there's no point. Then the Brahma Sahampati came and said, please, for those with just a little bit of dust, those with a small degree of addiction, then please teach. So I say, and it's also not to cheapen, you understand the word cheapen? Not to kind of diminish the value of Nibbana. It's like, oh, Nibbana is really easy, just relax, okay? You know, Ajahn Amaro told me I realized Nibbana. But it's, yeah, it is just relaxing, but it's also relaxing the bhava tanha. It's relaxing those habits of wanting to be something, be somebody, go somewhere, get something, get rid of something, you know. Because that's the addiction, and we feel like we're unsatisfied or we're lonely or we're insecure if we haven't got that being fed. So that the practice, in a way, is getting ourselves off the drug to learn how to really delight in peace, to delight in non-ownership, to delight in simplicity, to delight in independence, not needing anything. That's rare in the world. So that's a lot of work. Also, the grasping and identification, it's not just one level. You know, there's grasping on a social level, grasping on a physical level, and grasping on a psychological level. And so there can be, you can let go of some coarse things like, you know, giving up going to boxing matches or, you know, gambling or, you know, giving up you know, just coarse destructive things that kind of make you feel alive, you know. But there can be even though that's been given up, and this is a lot of the work in meditation retreats or in monasteries, it's like it's fairly easy to let go of the coarse kinds of sense desire, you know, sexual desire or desire for, you know, for food or possessions or being attractive or whatever. But then the subtle kinds of attachment can be almost invisible, that we don't even know that there's this feeling of I think, I remember, this is my life, these are my I'm happy, I'm unhappy, I'm sad, all those I ams and this is mine seem completely reasonable and ordinary. But then the more that the vipassana gamatana is developed, the more it's recognized, oh, that's also just another attachment, that I am feeling, that ahankara, the I am-ness, or the mine-ness, mamankara, this is mine, my body, my feeling, my memories, my Dhamma talk, yeah, my Dhamma center, you know, my responsibility, that ahankara, mamankara, they also need to be seen. There's a really interesting teaching in the suttas that I like to quote, called the Kemaka Sutta. And Kemaka was an old monk, and he's very sick. And so he's kind of approaching his death. And then his friends, other monks in the monastery, send a message to him saying, well, we hear that you're dying. Have you completed your practice yet? Have you arrived at arahantship yet? And then he's literally lying on his deathbed. He's really ill. So he tells the messenger, well, go and tell them that I haven't finished my work yet. Yeah, I haven't reached arahantship. So then the messenger goes back to his friends, and he comes back again and says, so they ask, in what way have you not finished your work? So he's dying, but his friends are still harassing him about, okay, what have you got left to... So it goes back and forth a little bit, a few times, and finally he gets fed up. And he gets up from his deathbed and kind of goes over to see these friends of his. And then he gives this very interesting, there's this very interesting dialogue. Because he says, so, let's put it this way. It's like a flower. You know, you can smell the fragrance of the flower, but you can't tell where the fragrance comes from. Is it from the petals? Is it from the stalk? Is it from the pollen? Is it from the stamens, the kind of the little fine frilly bits? Where's it coming from? You can smell it, but you can't tell where the fragrance is located. He said, in the same way, there's no attachment to any of the five khandhas, to the body, the feeling, the perception, mental formations, even to consciousness. But this I am feeling, still, it's around. But it's not attached to anything, like the fragrance of the flower. So that's, you know, that's where my mind has still been attached. Now, he actually became an arahant giving that description to his friends. So he's probably the only person who became enlightened hearing his own Dhamma talk. So the very special, and also some of his friends became arahants too. So it was a very useful exchange. So it was good that he got off his deathbed to have that dialogue. So that when we say, you know, just let go, that initial taste of Nibbāna, that kind of non-grasping, because in that moment, as Lumpo Puttatara would say, is sawang, sa'at, sangop. It's sawang, it's radiant, sa'at, pure, sangop, peaceful. But then that quality can also, behind that or underneath that, there can be other komyatua, yes, attachments going on, but they're not visible at that moment. So there's the flavor of Nibbāna, but as the practice is developed, then it's reaching down through more and more and more layers. And then so Sodaban, the stream entry, is where it reaches a certain level and can't reverse or can't be obscured completely. You know, as seven more births. So it means you can get totally lost no more than seven times. You know, you can get lost. but it'll be no more than seven times. And so on through Sakadagami, Anagami, and Arahat is like, when Arahat is realized, when that level is realized, then there's nothing can obscure that. That the experience of Nibbāna is right there in any moment, every moment.
Thank you so much. I received your message.
So...
Ajahn, thank you so much for coming tonight. It's nice to see you. Thank you for your teaching. You sort of answered my question already, but I wanted to see if you could expand a little bit on this idea of like temporary Nibbāna, because it sounds to me, and language, it's language sort of fails us, I think, in talking about things that are beyond the thinking mind. But it seems to me like what you're talking about would be what I would describe as like maybe an experience or an insight of anatta or emptiness. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, it's not that it's terribly common, but I think that, like, if one has had an insight into emptiness, is Nibbāna just sort of a matter of sort of, like, stringing together more of those experiences more often or having them last for longer periods of time? Or am I just, like, not even going in the right direction with this?
Now I say that's right on the mark.
Oh, great.
If I can speak about marks.
Okay.
No, that's exactly. So when we talk about anatta or sunyata, they're all just words that are pointing towards a particular quality. So not self is a tool that we can use to challenge the habits of selfing, and that it's a way of that I feel, I speak, I choose, I remember. It's saying, well, is that so? Or you know, who is that that's doing the remembering? Or what's this thing that is the owner of that thought? Yeah, where is it? What is it? Is it a person? Does it exist? So anatta is a method of exploring. Sunyata, similarly, they're tools to examine the nature of experience. So sunyata is a way of looking at that feeling of things being solid or things being self-existent. That this is a clock. Well, it's a clock insofar as the plastic and the metal and the other pieces got put together and arranged in a certain order, and then the sticks move around and it says 7:18. But it's not intrinsically a clock. It is what it is, and it's in a state of change, and it's come together, but you see, its clockness is empty. It's not. There's no absolute thing there. So those are just ways of kind of freeing the mind from its fixations. Also, often people have spontaneous experiences where you know, time and identity fall away. Sometimes when they're alone in the countryside by themselves, you know, there's just like a spontaneous falling away of personality, and the mind finds itself in a kind of clear, open state. It can be sometimes in an accident. You know, I know one guy who was in a mining accident, who lost his leg underground in a mining accident in Australia, and he was sort of lying there with his leg crushed, and his mind just went into a completely kind of clear, peaceful, open, blissful state. So I wouldn't recommend that as a method, but you know, sometimes where the normal reference points are suddenly they're pulled away or they fall away, then those kind of realizations are basically the mind losing its usual filters, its usual things that mask or obscure Dhamma. They fall away for some reason, and then in that moment there is peacefulness and clarity. And I'd say that those are fairly reliable. What the mind does with that after the experience is over is another story. And so with psychedelic drugs also, that is a big issue, because it can replicate those same kind of experiences, but then the side effects can be really disastrous. And also how the mind interprets that, because someone can have, or through a meditation retreat or some spontaneous experience, that kind of clarity can appear, but then they can say, well, I'm an arahant now, so therefore everything I do is pure. I can't create any bad karma because there's nobody here. You know, the mind grasps the idea. You know, the experience itself was genuine, but then whoop, the self-view kind of comes in and takes over again after that. The conditions that supported that experience are over. And so then self-view comes up. Well, I'm an arahant. You know, I can start running very expensive workshops, and you know, or attract disciples to me and get get a reputation for being this great enlightened being. And yeah, the experience when it happened, that insight was genuine, maybe. Yeah, and it was an unobstructed realization of truth, of Dhamma. But then the way the mind grasps hold of it and what it makes of it, then it turns it into a source of great suffering, both for the individual and other people around. So that is also one of the reasons why spiritual friendship and having good teachers is so important. That if you have those kind of insights, you come off a meditation retreat and you go, well, everything seems really clear. I better talk to my friend. And so I've had this kind of insight or this experience. What do you make of this? Or how does this sound? Or have you ever had this before? Or how does this fit with your understanding of things? So we use our friends, sort of trusted companions, as a kind of sounding board to check, and particularly experienced teachers who we feel are reliable. They say, well, I've had this experience, you know, what do you make of it? And to add to that, Lumpo Cha, particularly if it was some kind of powerful meditation effect, he would play it right down. I was just saying at another Dhamma talk I just gave earlier today, Jack Cornfield, who's a fairly well-known meditation teacher now, he was a monk with Ajahn Chah for a couple of years. And he was at Wat Pah Nanachat for about 2 years, then he went off and he was with Mahasi Sayadaw and the different Sayadaws in Burma. And he went to India to Nisargadatta Maharaj and various Hindu teachers and other Ajahns in Thailand. And he had some pretty powerful meditation experiences. And so he came back to Wat Pah Nanachat and Lumpur said, okay. So how was it? You know, you went to visit all these great Ajahns. So tell me, what did you learn? What was your experience like? So then Jack is kind of, and this is his own account as well. He's kind of pleased with himself. Like, well, you know, I was with Mahasi Sayadaw, and my whole body disappeared, and I had this kind of experience of sort of infinite light and infinite space. And I was in India with this Advaita Vedanta guru, and then there was this kind of profound wisdom and a sense of unity and da, da, da. So he's kind of listing these colorful and powerful experiences, and so he got to the end of his description and Lumpur Cha just said, ployed am I? Yeah. Can you let go of it? Like completely unimpressed. Because he could see, and again Jack was just, in the way Jack would describe it, it's like he could see this guy is proud of his, he's proud of his homework, He's kind of, so Ajahn Chah, he wasn't psychic, but he was a really good reader of body language. So he could see this lad is pleased with himself. There's, atta, the self view written large. So even though those meditation experiences were valid, and were, obviously showed that this person had some skill with concentration, with insight, and had some major spiritual potential. Still, at that moment, he could see, his ego is feeding on this, and that let's kind of look long, kind of lower it down a bit. So the message he gave was like, okay, so can you let go? And that, so that was, it was a teaching as well as a question. He was pointing to, can you see how much the mind is attaching to this? Can you see what you're doing? Because now it's a memory. It's not, you're not in that experience. It's not happening now. It's a memory. So what is your mind doing with this memory here and now? And so that's really, I feel, with these kind of insights, not just grasping the memory of them, either becoming inflated and thinking, I'm really somebody special and I'm a sotapanna or I'm an arahant, whatever. Or that, there's that one perfect moment, how can I get back there? What did I eat that day? Where was I sitting? How close to the window was I? And trying to replicate all the exact conditions so you can get that beautiful thing again. There's a story about Leo Tolstoy, the author, Russian author, and it's said that he was a high-ranking landowner, you know, he was like a kind of aristocrat, but he used to like to go and help on the farms with the farm workers, and the story goes that he was out cutting corn with them one day with a scythe, you know, and he got his mind went into this state of kind of blissful rapture, and he cut acres and acres of corn, and his body was completely relaxed. It was no effort. He was in this blissful state, and there was this kind of huge amount of corn was cut. And the end of the day, he thought, "Wow," or the Russian equivalent, you know, "Wow, that was amazing." And it said he spent the next 20 years cutting incredible amounts of corn, trying to get back to that state. To get to that feeling, but he didn't realize it wasn't the corn, it was the mind. It's not, you know, and that's always the thing that makes a difference. So, but I'm noticing now it's 7:27, so maybe it's time to wrap things up for this evening.